and with any of the Victoria Arduino machines, they tend to cover them in a very nice cover.
Right.
It's not a plastic cover.
Plastic sheeting,
yeah,
I guess.
It's
okay.
Just a very nice material which you can actually use in your shop.
Oh, why?
So if you wanted to cover your machine at night, protect it or whatever, you could reuse this, and it looks nice.
Yeah,
and it's a nice material.
Wonderful.
So, yeah, as you can see, we have auto steams on each side, and the way these auto steams will work is you can actually have two different temperatures. In this case, we got the auto steam only. We didn't do auto frothing. If you had auto frothing, then you can actually have two different temps and two different froth settings on each. So you have one setting there, one setting up. And of course your hot water. Here again, they have very nice heavy side panels on them.
This seems marred.
I think it just needs to be buffed out.
It's cleaned out, okay.
So in my shop, We're going to go ahead and bench test this unit, and then we'll go ahead and do a quick tear down on it, just so we're familiarizing, because this is a newer machine from New Orleans Simonelli to us. And one thing we like to do is obviously bench test them, make sure they're working correctly, and also do a quick tear down so that we are familiar with the machines before we go out in the field with them.
Oh, it is.
Yes.
Okay.
So the machine will come with two doubles and a single, which we never use the singles. Typically, we'll convert the single into a triple. It will come.
What do you mean you convert a single into a triple?
Most of our customers, most everyone that we have does not do single shots.
Okay.
They may want to do triple shots.
Okay.
So then we will put a triple basket in the single portafilter and use that as a triple.
Oh, you don't need a different portafilter? You can use
no.
a single?
Yeah.
Okay. You just need a triple basket.
Yeah, you just need a triple
okay.
basket. And then, of course, well, if it's a three group, it'll come with three doubles, and it'll come with three blind filters. In this case, it's two groups, so there's two blind filters for your cleaning. It has an automatic cleaning program to it. The other thing they do give you is they give you the competition steam tips if you want to put those on. So, and those are just so that you're slowing down and able to get a better texture and frothing. In this case, it's going through to a drive-through, so it's more about a little more about performance and speed than it is about, doing latte art. You're not going to do latte art in a drive-through because they'll never see it. And they also give you a nice 58 millimeter tamper with it. And of course, Victoria Arduino. So this machine comes in different steaming configurations. It can come in a manual steaming, which is still electro valve operated. So it's still the same. You're just operating it by turning it on and then turning it off. And then, of course, you can get an auto steam, which is the case here. Which it's just gonna, you just pre-program the temp setting you want it to turn off at. And then there is the Easy Cream, and the Easy Cream is a auto frothing steam wand. So it'll have a different tip here, but internally it'll have a pump system that will inject air into the steam for your frothing. And of course you can tell it how much that you want it to froth, or you know, you can set the level of that in addition to the temperature. Keep in mind that frothing wands are made to do with fresh milk. In other words, if you auto froth and you don't utilize all that milk, you can reuse that milk, but typically you're not going to want to froth it again because you're just frothing on top of what you've already got frothed. So the, any auto frothing works best with just a fresh milk that hasn't been steamed before.
Okay. So if you're out looking for a frothing, you know, you're shopping, comparative shopping, what do you want to look for in a frothing wand?
Generally, the best systems work off of a pump instead of a venturi, although Rancilio has done a good job with theirs, and that's typically a venturi.
The venturi slows it down, doesn't it?
It slows it down a lot. Okay.
Are there any other disadvantages to having a venturi system?
No, that was,
that would be that. That would be it.
Because you have to slow down the steaming process to get the air injection. And now we'll just do, go ahead and do a quick tear down of this machine to remove the top panels. It's just two Phillips screwdrivers in the back, which we've already removed. And then, of course, to remove your side panels, you're just loosening. And this can be done without removing the top pieces. So you just loosen those.
How'd that pop out?
So it slides right in there, and then there's pins right there underneath here. These are sliding right into there. Okay. So you're hooking from underneath and then up and then fastening it up. So one of the unique features of this machine that they've gone away from, so there used to be a T3 system. So in a sense, this is not really a T3. In other words, there's no heat exchangers in our steam boiler. So they've gone to where the water comes in. The water is coming in and it's actually going through a loop inside of the drain box. And they're using that. So any discharge of our coffees and stuff going down there and off of our expansion valves, which will be hot, that's kind of preheating the water before it comes up and gets dispersed through our flow meters and then into our brew boilers. So our brew boilers are a lot smaller, but they have a 600 watt element in it. So it does not take much to heat that water that's inside of here. Then from here, it's going into our group head, which has a 300 watt element. So that is our final stage of heating if it needs to be heated.
Is that where they are setting the temp?
That's where you're setting your actual end temp is at your brew boiler.
Okay.
Generally speaking, we set both of these the same.
Okay.
We will set them the same temperature.
Okay.
People have played with, you know, making this one hotter or cooler before the brew boiler and say that there's a difference. But most of the people I've talked to say we haven't found any difference in that. So,
okay. So I just want to clarify on the original T3 system that they had on the Aurelia Wave T3 and and the Black Eagle.
The Black Eagle.
They have heat exchangers,
which you're preheating the water.
Through the steam boiler.
The steam boiler.
Okay.
Then to your
the brew boiler, which was probably larger.
Which was larger, okay. Yes. It's about, I would say, almost twice the size. Maybe not quite.
Okay.
But pretty close.
So the design is actually still a three-tiered design.
Yes, it's still a three-tiered design because they're preheating the water down in the drain tray.
But better, more energy efficient.
Way more energy efficient because they're just reusing the energy that's coming off of our brew valves and stuff.
Okay. So they're using a pressure transducer in the steam boiler?
Yes, so they're using a pressure transducer. You will see that there is a mechanical pressure switch down in here. It's buried way in there.
Okay.
But that is only used as a safety device. That's all it's used for. And of course, we have a secondary pressure transducer, and that is for measuring our brewing pressure. So if you look at the front of the machine, you see there is no, there's no gauge here. So our gauge is going to be in our screen. It's going to tell us what our steam pressure is and what our brewing pressure is. So steam boiler, This is our fill probe for the steam boiler, heating element for the steam boiler. So this is a 3000 watt element. So this is only a 3000 watt element versus normally on their two groups, they would have a 4500 watt, but we don't have any heat exchangers. I mean, what you can compare this to is to like a Lamerzoco Linea two group. That's 3000 watts.
Okay. Same thing. And all it's used is for steaming.
Yeah, all it's used is for steaming and your hot water.
So you're not depending on the your steam boiler for any brewing whatsoever.
Correct. And of course, the nice thing about this unit is on our hot water, we have a cold mix valve or economizer valve. So this is our steam valve, which whether it's an auto steam, an auto frothing, or just a regular steam, you're going to have this valve.
Okay. Does that need to be rebuilt?
No, it's replaceable, but it's not rebuildable, but you would replace it. And its life is typically 2.5 to 3.5 years.
Okay.
But thus is why when you go to electro valves for your steaming, you get, there's less maintenance up front. But it's, you know, not that hard to just change a steam valve either versus rebuilding a whole mechanical valve.
So when you look at rebuilding, you're looking at the technician's travel, or they're there to do the preventive maintenance anyway. Right. But it's the labor that you're going to invest
in. It's the labor. Obviously, a mechanical valve is less in parts.
They are spendy, though. They can be spendy.
They can be spendy, yes.
How much time would it take you to swap that out?
Well, it's not the actual swap out of the valve. It's the whole process of doing it. Shutting the machine down, depressurizing it, opening up the machine. But the valve itself, probably within a half hour, you can get it changed out.
Okay.
Less time than that.
So, but you're only going to be doing this every 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay.
You're still going to be doing wanting to do a major maintenance once a year on the machine, but that's one less thing that you have to worry about.
Okay. Great.
But you do want to change it out before it actually fails, because otherwise you're going to be down a steam wand or it's going to be leaking or something.
Right.
Typically they leak before they actually all out fail. So our steam boiler solid state relays are right behind here. And then of course, right in front of that is our board for our solid state relays and activation board for our brewing groups and our brew group head heating elements.
That's the main board?
That is not the main board. The main board is way over here.
Now, what is the difference between the two?
The main board is sending a signal over here telling it what to do. Okay. So, of course, here we got our brew boiler, our initial boiler. And, of course, this is our temperature sensor right here on the side. These are just safety devices on top in case of a direct dry boiler heat or a overheat. And of course, underneath is the boiler is where the heating element is. And the heating element is replaceable. And boilers that are this small, sometimes they weld them into the boiler.
So you're just replacing the boiler. Okay. Yeah.
But in this case, that's not the case. And of course, here's our flow
meter.
What
do you mean? You can change the heating elements in these boilers?
Yeah, you can change the heating element in these.
Okay, wonderful. Okay.
And of course, the heating element can be changed in our brew group.
Now, not to go off on a thing, but a lot of times people don't want to buy systems like this because they think they're higher in maintenance. Because now you've got how many heating elements in this machine? You've got at least three.
Well,
the boiler, right?
You've got
four.
Five.
One, two,
you
three,
have
four, five. Oh, you don't have a heating element in the initial heat up?
No.
Okay. So you have five heating elements, but heating elements don't typically go out, do they?
No, they can. They can go out through time, but generally they go out because of water quality issues, mineral being built up around them.
Yes.
That would be a reason for failure. It is not unheard of for just an element just to fail. It can. But usually that's several years down the road. A lot of times an element can last the life of the machine. It's just hit and miss.
Okay.
I've had some machines where we had the water quality is good, but on the steaming element, for whatever reason, one of the elements went bad. You know, so we went to 2/3 power. So it happens. You know, it could just be, you know, a manufacturer flaw from the beginning and was doomed to fail sooner or later.
Okay.
So
just bad luck.
Yeah.
Just to come out, I just had a quick question. So is this group head like the Black Eagle group head or similar?
It is similar, within the buttons are the same. And you have a timer on the group head.
That's very nice.
So
What I wanted to ask is the material that this is made of. Now, I know you have these in the field. How do they wear? Do they look banged up or?
No, I haven't had that issue with, because we have White Eagles and we have Black Eagles in the field currently. And as far as this chrome group goes, we haven't had any issues with, I mean, obviously if someone's going to start banging on them, they're going to,
there's nothing you can do.
But in general, with them keeping them clean and any fading or, you know, chipping or anything like that, we have not had that.
That's wonderful. Because, you know, sometimes I look at a machine and you say it'll last 20 years.
Yeah. This is not a plastic, though. This is a metal. Some manufacturers will use a plastic. And that's where we'll have issues with the chrome chipping off.
Okay.
Because these are metal, they tend not to chip at all.
That's wonderful, because they look like polished chrome.
Yeah.
You know, when you talk about a machine, if you put quality water in it, it's going to last a long time. But physically, you know, do you want to own a 20-year-old machine? Will it look nice after 20 years, I guess is what I'm saying.
It all depends on the customer, if they can maintain that look and take care of it.
Okay.
You know, and of course you can always refurb something. You know, you just have to weigh the cost of
new
versus refurbing it. Yeah, you can always refurb it for cheaper than a new one, but do you know, it comes down to what components are still available on a machine.
Okay. Right. And sometimes you just want new because your business wants that, I don't know what word.
Well,
do you know what
upgrade.
I mean?
Typically, you're going to upgrade on a machine. You're going to get something that has better features, or, you know, temperature stability has come a long way with everyone. So, you know, now it's coming down to features like low pressure pre-infusion or individual group temperatures. So this, we have the individual group temperatures, but we do not have the ability of a low pressure or a
pre or post infusion
or a more restricted pre-infusion.
And you don't have the ability to fluctuate temperatures, even though they try to do that.
Currently there's only one manufacturer doing that. You have the ability to change your temperature, like if you wanted one group to be at 198 and the other one be at 202, you can do that.
But you can't fluctuate. You can't fluctuate temperature with it while you're brewing.
Right.
Okay. So there's three things you can do with a machine. You can do things with pressure, do things with heating. And I guess that's it, right? Pressure and heating.
Pressure, heating, or temperature. Restriction, which is kind of the same thing as pressure. You're just restricting the flow more.
Okay. All right. We went on a tangent. Sorry. Okay.
So group heads already, you know, so group heads are independently temperature controlled. Our brew boiler is independently temperature controlled. Here's our flow meter, so one per group. And of course, that's a check valve on the flow meter. There is an expansion valve coming off our brew group there. And of course, there's a main expansion valve underneath off our main water supply. This T-fitting right up here is for our steam boiler. So we got our vacuum or anti-siphon valve up here. And then we got our pressure, overpressure safety valve right here. So if for some reason the machine were to keep heating and overpressure the steam boiler, that will open up and you will know it because there'll be steam everywhere. Of course, this is our group two. This is our hot water valve solenoid for hot water. And here's our cold mix to that. And of course, your adjustment of how much cold mix you want to adjust your temperature of your final output of your hot water. And then our steam boiler fill solenoid is buried down in there. And of course, our pump is straight down there too, and pump motor. So this is our main control board, main CPU board. So pump motor, this is our mains power relay to, so this is only energized when it does an initial fill and then it energizes sending power through to heat and it stays energized anytime the machine is on. And of course our pump itself is right here. Our adjustment we discussed about is underneath the machine. Our fill solenoid is straight back there.
Oh, I see it, yeah.
That's to fill the steam boiler.
You like a little pointer. Like, yeah. A little pixie stick or something.
I have one here. But I'm afraid because I have got the machine energized. So it's right there.
Don't use it. Yeah.
Can you see it now?
Yeah. Thank you. Are there different size legs? Or that's the standard?
That is the standard. That is it.
So how do you remove the drain tray?
Drain tray is very simple. So obviously you got the grid that'll come out. Tray just slides straight out. And of course now we have access to our front panel, which we just need to loosen two screws. And then you just slide that down. Oh, and this has an auto rinse.
Surprise!
So I'm turning it off.
Okay.
So yeah, that's the other nice feature this has. It has an auto rinse to it.
Now you disconnected an auto rinse on an Aurelio Wave digit.
We disconnected it because we were losing the performance, that because it was a two group and they were so busy on the window, we were losing temp.
So you were desperate.
We were getting inconsistent temps, and that's where this machine is going. So now we're going to have the auto steam again, and we'll be able to, you know, basically run the machine
nonstop.
And not have to worry about it, and also have the feature of the auto rinse.
Okay, wonderful. They're gonna love it.
Yep.
And the issue with that particular location was size.
We could not put a three group in there.
Now,
and of course, nor could we put a higher wattage element in it. So. It was an Aurelia Wave digit. It has a 4,500 watt element. They don't make a higher wattage element for it.
I know that people say, you know, this is very compact. So having two baristas on this machine would be a struggle, obviously.
On a two group, you will never have two baristas on a two group.
Anyway. Okay. So if you went to a three group, it still would be tight.
It might be tight, yes.
But for
this particular client, they only have one barista on a two group or on a three group. And they have the other baristas prepping, taking the orders, getting the orders out.
So this was really a machine that was purchased to solve a problem.
Yes. And to get the temperature stability that we need at our brewing.
So it needed
to be. That was the main thing.
How many drinks do you want this machine to deliver in this location? At least 600 a day?
For the side it's doing, it'll probably do 400 drinks a day.
At least.
On that side.
Okay.
Because so it's not the amount of drinks that you're producing. It's in that I'm running the machine nonstop. You can do 100 drinks a day, but if you all do it in 30 minutes, you need the performance level to do that 30 minutes. You can do 1,000 drinks a day, but if you just do it throughout the whole day, most machines will be able to do that.
What size is that pump that I'm looking at right here?
So that is, their standard is 200 liter an hour.
Okay. Pumps. That's pretty standard, isn't
that
it?
That is their standard, yeah.
Okay.
They don't go less than that. Obviously, on their one groups, they do 100 liter hour pump on that.
Okay.
But they're two, on all of their 2 and 3 and 4 group machines, they're 200 liters an hour. Then on there, you can always, like on some four groups, we've done 300 liter hour pumps. Typically, it's on a different manufacturer.
Why is pump size important?
Because you need that stability in constant brewing pressure. In other words, if you only had 100 liter an hour pump, on this, you go to brew one on here, then you go to brew here, the pump pressure dives a little bit. Then you run the hot water at the same time. Now it even dives more.
So and then need, the machine you, refills.
Yeah, you need, and it refills. Although these machines, you can program them not to do a refill while you're brewing.
Oh, nice. Okay.
We typically don't do that, but you can do that.
You typically don't program it not to do that.
Yes, and the reason being is if they're really busy and they're using a lot of hot water, guess what?
You need a refill.
You're going to need a refill.
Okay.
So powering your machine, now granted I have the drip tray removed, but normally you're going to want to turn it off from the front. You just press and hold until it clicks off. And of course, to press to power it back on, same thing, press and hold to power it on. But there is also another power switch which kills power to everything, which is underneath here. So if you turn that off, it kills power to everything. Common problem, cleaning crew comes in, accidentally hits a switch from cleaning underneath the machine. You come in, the sure sign is there is no display. So that means it was not turned off from the front. It's turned off from underneath.